know that, and hopefully when we get through this morning, you'll say, yeah, I can see some of that. So, well, what's wrong with Jonah? Well, you know the story of Jonah. Jonah chapter 1 starts out, verse 1, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. Nineveh, the Jews and the Ninevites, they were not good neighbors. They hated each other. And of course, the Jews, understanding, especially Jonah, he is kind of spiritually full of himself. He thinks that, you know, we're okay. We have God, so that makes us better than everybody else. And so, and they were quite proud of that. Problem with the Ninevites is, and it says in verse 2, it says that they were wicked. It was a great city, big city, of about 600,000 people. But it was wicked. And so the Jews looked down their nose at the Ninevites. Now, Jonah is a prophet, called of God, set apart, and prophets are supposed to do what God asked them to do, except for Jonah. Jonah is supposed to be going to Nineveh, verse 3. Now Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa. He found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare thereof, went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. It's amazing when you think about the fact that God called him to go to Nineveh, and that's kind of like going up, and then everything from the time it says that he's leaving the presence of the Lord, Jonah continues to do what? The word means something. He continued to go down. He went down to Joppa. He's going down to Tarshish, and he's going away from the presence of the Lord. What's wrong with Jonah? Jonah has his own view of who he thinks God is and how God ought to act, how God ought to treat other people. Jonah thinks, well, you know, we're your chosen people, we're the Jews, so we have special favor. And so he's got his own, in his own mind, he's sort of set up in his own mind how God needs to judge people and how God needs to react. Would you say that Jonah was prejudiced? Yeah. You think that Jonah had a narrow view of who God was? Yes. Jonah is a mess, to be honest. Jonah didn't care about any other people. All he cared about, really, when it gets down to it, not even the Jews so much, he cared about himself. He has a little light that shines. You say, well, there may be some hope, because by the time you get to chapter 1, Jonah looks like, you know, he's going to do the right thing. Well, you know the story. He goes down. He's on the ship. He's going to Tarshish. God sends a great wind. There's a storm. Jonah goes in the bottom of the ship. He's taking a nap. And the men are up top, and they're just scared to death. They're trying to figure out how they're going to survive this storm. They begin to pray unto their false gods. And so finally, they go down. They wake up Jonah. And they said, listen, I'm giving you the short version of this. Listen, you need to pray unto your God and ask him to help us. Or if you've done something wrong, that's part of that image that God creates us in. You've done something wrong, you need to own up to it, confess it, and repent of it so that your God will give us favor. Jonah goes up and he says, it is my fault, I'm running away from God. And so, but listen to what the men do. This is amazing. In verse 13, nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to the land, but they could not. They were going to try to save Jonah, because Jonah said, the only way we're going to get out of this is you have to throw me into the sea. They had more compassion on Jonah than Jonah had on anybody else, especially the Ninevites. Why is that? Because, you see, Jonah's got his own picture of how God's supposed to act, and he's really using God as a big stick. You know, okay, Lord, you punish the Ninevites and you punish these people, but you bless us because we're special. We're your people. Now, I'm pressing this point because we're going to get there in a minute. Jonah said, well, the only way we're going to get out of this, the only way you're going to be saved is you got to throw me in the sea. You're thinking, boy, Jonah, what a great thing. What a sacrifice. Jonah, you're learning your lesson. You're going away from God. Now he's thrown into the sea, and you come to chapter 2, the Bible says that God prepared a great fish. Jesus called it a whale. And it scooped up Jonah, and then we have the issue where Jonah's in the belly of the whale for 3 days. Listen to what Jonah says in verse verse 2 of chapter 2. I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell I cried, and thou heardest my voice. For thou hast cast me into the deep, in the midst of the seas, and the floods compassed me about. All thy billows and thy waves, they passed over me. Yet I cried out, and I promise you that if I get out of this, I will cast my voice, and I will look toward your temple, Jerusalem. He's confessing, and he's repenting. But now, is it genuine? Well, you get down to chapter 2, verse 10 ends up, the fish vomits him out on the land. He goes to Nineveh, and for 4 days he goes about preaching, verse 2, unto the city. It was a 3 days journey, and he goes around. I'm sorry, he cried out 40 days that Nineveh was going to be overthrown, that God was going to judge them because of their wickedness. For 40 days he did this. It took him 3 days to go across the city. So he's crisscrossing the city, and he's crying out. He's doing everything that God has asked him to do. So he's doing well. The end of the chapter, chapter 4, it talks about how that his heart really is exposed. This is where I want to get to this morning. Chapter 1, he runs away from God. He's swallowed up by a fish. But he did save the men on the boat. That was a good thing. He's in the belly of the whale in chapter 2. He finally, it sounds like he's coming around. Chapter 2 ends up, he's vomited up on the ground. He goes straight to Nineveh. For 40 days, he proclaims that God is going to judge the Ninevites because of their wickedness. Chapter 3 ends up, the king hears about it. Everybody's in sackcloth and ashes. They even put sackcloth on the animals. I mean, everybody's repenting. Everybody's afraid God is going to keep his word. And then in chapter 4, listen to this. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. He's been swallowed by a whale. He almost drowned in the ocean. He goes and he preaches what God told him to do. And then when you get to the end of chapter 3, it says, and God saw their works, that they turned from their evil ways, and God repented of the evil that he said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. In verse 4, chapter 4, verse 1, it says, and Jonah was displeased. Let me ask you a question. Who's God in this thing right here? Sounds like Jonah is. He's not happy that the Ninevites, all 600,000 of them, were not destroyed. I mean, he's displeased. I didn't have time. I should have looked it up and found out what the word displeased means in Hebrew. It means he was not happy. He was mad. What about you? You pray and you ask God to do something, and he answers it, but he answers it in another way. And have you ever done this? You stand back and you say, I would have done it this way. It would have turned out better if this would have happened. Especially when it comes to seeing someone who has done you wrong or someone who has hurt you, and you're asking the Lord to do something to intervene, and all of a sudden something happens and they repent, but you didn't get your full pound of flesh and you're not happy about it. You just wanted a little bit more. Lord, if you'd have just done this. See, that's the Jonah in all of us. By the way, not only do we have a little bit of Jonah in us, we also have some Simon Peter in us too. You know, the guy that makes all the vows and you can't hardly keep any of them? It's called the foot and mouth syndrome. So Jonah's displeased. So the Lord's going to take and teach him another personal lesson. Jonah goes up on the hillside, he's sitting up there, and you know what he's doing while he's sitting up there? He's waiting for the judgment to fall on Nineveh. He wants the place to be toasted, like Sodom and Gomorrah. That's really what he wants. And so it gets hot, and the Lord sends a gourd, and has a big leaf on it, and he brings him shade, and it cools him off. And then the Lord sends a worm, and you know this, and the worm comes, and the worm kills the gourd. And Jonah's just all discouraged, all depressed. Listen to what God says to him. And it came to pass, verse 8, when the sun did rise, that God prepared a vehement east wind. The sun beat down upon the head of Jonah, that he fainted and wished in himself to die, and he said, it is better for me to die than to live. God said to Jonah, doest thou well to be angry for the gourd? It's the one with the worm killed. And he said, I do well to be angry, even unto death. Then the Lord said, thou hast had pity on the gourd for the which thou hast not labored, neither made it grow, which came up in the night, perished in the night. And should not I spare Nineveh, that great city, wherein are more than 600,000 people that cannot discern between their right hand and their left, and also much cattle? Jonah, your values are all mixed up. You're more concerned about a tree that can't give you shade than you are about 600,000 people. You're all concerned about the fact that, you know, you got a raw deal somewhere, and instead about the real fact of what's going on around us. Let me talk to you just as we close about values. Are you more concerned about the here and now, the temporary, than you are about the eternal? I'm learning this about myself. When I get focused on the here and now, my eternal value, that stock, begins to just decrease because I don't look at it. I don't pay attention to it. I ignore it. I'm not concerned about it. And there's probably times when I come and I say, you know, Lord, I've been good. I mean, I've answered your call. I've done all the things you've asked me to do. You know, Lord, I want you to bless me. Like, bless me materially. Lord, give me some stuff. And then I get kind of haughty. Now you look at me like, how could you do that? Be careful, there's a mirror looking back at you. Lord, you owe me. Because I've been good. Then we catch ourselves because we know better. Lord, if I got what I deserve, I'd be in hell today. Lord, if I got what I deserve, I wouldn't be able to breathe the air that you give me with a good pair of lungs. Lord, I wouldn't be able to do this. I wouldn't be able to. And then when something does happen, all of a sudden life gets real simple. And it's amazing how when life gets simple, how grateful we become just for a good day when I don't hurt. A good day when I can remember things. A good day when I can appreciate a sunrise or a smile or a little granddaughter runs up and wants to hold my finger. That's a good day. Then I think back on the days when I said, Lord, you need to go get those people over there because they're bad. They cause trouble. They're just a noise. Lord, those people over there, they don't work hard. They're bums. They're lazy. They're on the dole. They're on welfare. They're sorry. And they don't, you know, no eating, no working. I mean, just forget it, Lord. But that's not my call, is it? And it's not your call either. How do you know that God's not doing something in their lives, a work of grace? How about North Korea? We think that guy over there, he's a lunatic. Yeah, but what about the millions of people that are sitting under him in bondage? He can't even feed them, and he's buying weapons and having parades. And what about the fact that, what about their eternal value? What about the fact that we're smuggling people in over there and Bibles in over there, and their life is on the line so they can get the gospel message, which is eternal value? Why am I more upset about the fact that he might nuke Hawaii and I can't go there on vacation than I am the fact that he starved to death millions of his own people? My values are all mixed up. See, Jonah, his value system is just messed up. What he thought was top priority, God said, that's not even on the list. Let me challenge you today. Check your value priority list. What's most important? Is it eternity and the things of eternity? Kingdom business, sharing the gospel, being grateful for the little things in life, or is it about making sure that if you were God and you were king, boy, everything would be right, and I'd get my pound of flesh. You mess with me, you're going to pay for it. Or is it going to be like Jesus? The world messed with Jesus, and what did he give him in return? Forgiveness and life and grace. Because that's what they needed. That's what they need. Today, we're all going to be tested. Every one of us. Whether it's at a red light sitting in your car, or whether it's in a store, whether it's at home. How are you going to respond? You going to retaliate? retaliate, our value system is wrong. But if we respond with grace and patience and gentleness, then maybe, just maybe, God is working in our hearts and we're letting Him do that. We're letting Him. He never said passing through this world is going to be easy. That's why this is not heaven. We're not home yet. And I don't have to look too far to see that. Sirens, things going on. That's the reality where we are. That siren tells us somebody's in trouble, somebody's in need. I pray the spiritual siren's going off in your heart today, saying, be careful, look out, slow down, listen. God comes with mercy and grace and forgiveness because that's what you and I need. And once we experience that, and we really experience that, that'll be the first thing we want to get.